We are going to continue the series that we started last week on the church in Corinth, the book of 1 Corinthians, and so I invite you to take out your Bibles and turn with me back to the first chapter of Corinthians, Corinthians 1, and we're going to be looking at verses 10 through 16 this morning. Last week we looked at the first nine verses, and this morning we're going to begin moving forward with verses 10 through 16. If you are able, I invite you to stand as we hear God's word this morning, as we stand before the living word as he speaks to us. Paul writes, 1 Corinthians 1, beginning at verse 10. I appeal to you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another, so that there will be no divisions among you, that you may be perfectly united in mind and in thought. My brothers, some from Chloe's household have informed me that there are quarrels among you. What I mean is this. One of you says, I follow Paul. Another, I follow Apollos. Another, I follow Cephas. And still another, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you not baptized into the name of Paul? I am thankful that I did not baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized into my name. Yes, I also baptized the households of Stephanas, and beyond that, I don't remember if I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with words of human wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. If you recall, last week I introduced you to this ancient city of Corinth. And in Corinth, we found this melting pot of people, where people were crossing, coming from the north and the south, the east and the west, and there was this place where all these people at points were gathered together. And some of them stayed. And as a result, Corinth was a city where there were many different worldviews, many different ideologies. Corinth was also a city where there was a lot of problems. It was a city that was very sinful. It was a city of drunkenness, a city of sexual immorality, a city of pagan practices, idols. But all of these people, much like you and I, actually no different than you and I, were looking for someone to follow. Someone or something to put their stake in and say, this is what I stand for. This is who I am. And so Paul is writing to a church and asks them, who are you going to follow? Now, we all follow someone, something. We follow certain sports teams. We follow certain political parties. We follow certain social media. On Facebook, we have certain friends that we follow, and we make sure we push like on things that they post. When we're kids, we have friends, right? As adults, we always want our children to pick good friends because they follow their friends. They hang out with their friends, and they follow them. They are influenced by their friends. As adults, we also have people that we follow. Sometimes it's a crowd. We see that something's popular, and pretty soon we have the same thing that is popular. We are told that this is something you have to have, and we hear that someone had it, and they said, you have to have this. And so we have to have this. And so we go get it. We follow certain people, certain things. And whatever we follow has a certain sense of control over us. Now, the nice thing about us, especially in the world that we live in, in the country we live in, we have freedom. We have freedom to follow whoever we choose. We have freedom to change and to pick different things to follow. We have a freedom to pick and choose and to do a multitude of different things in our life. And so Paul is talking to a church that has the same thing going on. They have a multitude of choices in Corinth. They have a multitude of different things they can follow, not only in the city, but also in the church. And they get caught up in who they're following and how it looks, how they appear. And so Paul makes an appeal. He has told them that you have received all these blessings. You have been enriched by God. You have been given faith. You have you lack no spiritual gifts, if you recall last week. And God is faithful in providing these things. They will keep coming. You have everything you need. All that you could ask for. And so Paul appeals to them, and the appeal, it's not like, watch out, shame on you. No, it's an appeal. It's the same word as the word we use for the Holy Spirit, paraclete. The root is the same root. And the Holy Spirit comes alongside us to help us. And so Paul is coming alongside them and saying, I want to help you. I'm not here to judge or condemn, but I'm here to help. Because I want what's best for you. I want you to experience the richness of God's blessing. And so he says to you, I appeal to you. And I appeal to you in the name of Christ. Paul is appealing just as I am preaching to you, not in my name, not for my benefit, not so that you continue to bring offerings in so that my salary can be paid, not so that you can say, we really like that, Pastor. That's not. I am supposed to be here just as Paul was there preaching and appealing and writing a letter to the Corinthian church in the name of Christ for Christ. And so he says, I'm appealing to you in the name of Christ. You see, Paul recognizes that there's a problem. The church is divided. There are schisms. And when we use the word schism, which is a word we don't use very often, but a schism is a dividing. Not a clean dividing, but it's sort of the difference between cutting a piece of paper with a nice, sharp cutting board or a scissors, or when you try to tear a straight line. There's a difference. Usually when you try to tear it, there's jagged edges. It's not as clean. And so a schism is a tearing. There are jagged edges, and on these jagged edges there is pain, there is suffering. And so he says, your church is divided. It's schismatic, and there's pain and there's suffering in your church. You have been set apart to be the church of Christ. He has equipped you and given you all that you need. He has provided everything. He's given it all to you. All there is, all there is to give, all he has to offer, and you have decided to be divided against yourselves. When there is pain and suffering in the body of Christ, the whole body suffers. my infection last week is a good illustration. The infection was only in one certain area of the body, but the whole body responded, trying to get rid of the infection. And it didn't care if it was causing me some suffering and pain. It was doing its job trying to get rid of the infection. And so the whole body is affected when there is trouble in the church. And so Paul appeals to the church. And he says, there are supposed to be no divisions among you. You are supposed to be united as one body, serving the head. You do it together, and you do it in unison. You do it in harmony. You do it in unity. And he says, you are to be perfectly united, complete. Now, the term for perfectly united is a term that means, it's the same term that is used when the fishermen Peter were mending the nets, fixing the nets so that they could catch fish. It's the same term that's used when you talk about mending garments, fixing garments, and putting garments back together. It's the same term that is used for broken vessels. You know, we talk about, Scripture talks about that we are this broken vessel, this clay pot. But we have a treasure within. And the treasure is more important than the vessel. Holding on to the treasure is more important than worrying about the pot. Because the pot is going to be repaired and fixed and restored from the inside out. And so he says you need to be completely united and allow that healing, that mending, that fixing to happen from the inside, and it'll come to the outside. It's not about which congregation we are a part of, which denomination we belong to. It's not about whether we wear suits and ties and dresses, hats, or jeans and shorts. It's not about whether we wear the right thing, do the right thing. It's about who we are. Who are we? Well, we all have names. We all have jobs, things that we do, places we go to school. And so our identity is often found in those things. But Jesus asks us, who are you? And I hope that our answer is, I'm your child. I belong to you. And you're my hero. You're the one I serve. You're the one I love. You're the one I adore. What can I do for you today? That's what it's about. And we're not carbon copies. We're not cookie cutter Christians. We don't all look the same. We don't all act the same. We don't all do the same things. And so there is diversity within the unity. But Paul says there is a problem. And so let's identify the problem. He says that I hear, I have received word from Chloe's household that there are divisions among you. I hear that you are quarreling. Now, quarrel is a good word. Now, quarrel isn't just an argument. Quarrel means that there's little barbs, right? And These barbs are sticking and pricking people. And these barbs are being used regularly. And so there's, and there's pain. And people are avoiding each other because they don't want to be stuck with the barbs. And so there's division. They probably all came. Now, Corinth was not a megachurch. Corinth was a church probably not much bigger than what we are here today. But yet they were probably coming to worship together, but yet they were not united. They were like, they probably had five aisles in church so that they could sit on their own side. No, I don't know. But they weren't united the way God wanted them to be united. And Paul says, who are you listening to? Some of you say we follow Paul. Some we say Apollos. Some Peter. And some say, well, I follow Christ. Well, yeah. So they said they followed Paul. Well, Paul was the original founder of the church. He's the one who came and started the church. He's the father of the church. Of course, we want to follow Paul. He's the one that got us started. But along came Apollos. Now, Paul would admit that he was not a very good speaker. He didn't have eloquent words. But Apollos was so smooth with words. It was like music to people's ears. He was an eloquent speaker. When he spoke, they just went, they couldn't help but listen to him. And so we must follow him. And others said, Peter. Well, Peter was the person who actually knew Jesus. Peter was a person who actually lived with Jesus. And so if you want to hear about Jesus, you go to the source. If you want to know about Jesus, Peter is the one to go to. And then there's those few that say, I just follow Christ. Well, who can say anything against that, right? It's like a kid answering a question, and the answer for every question is Jesus. Who can go wrong with Jesus? But the problem isn't that the problem wasn't with Peter, Apollos, and Paul and Christ. They were all preaching a message. And I would dare say that all of them were preaching a gospel message. The problem was with the people. And they would gravitate toward one and say, this one is better than the other, and so therefore I am better than those of you who aren't following this person. It was a pride issue. They were trying to be the people that God wanted them to be, and they were taking it into their own hands, and they were saying that I have accomplished and I have reached the point, and the rest of you keep trying. No, there are times in our life when we feel we've reached the point, but what happens? We fall. We fall off the mountain, right? We've climbed the mountain. We've reached the epitome of our life. It's like, oh, I've arrived. And all of a sudden, we find ourselves at the bottom of the mountain, all scraped and beat up. And then what do? Do we walk away? No. No. We, as a church, we surround each other and help each other because we know that each of us are going to fall at times. And sometimes it's going to be me that falls, and I'm going to need help. Sometimes it's someone else that falls, but we all work together. Of course, we're all here together to do what God wants us to do and to honor him. And so Paul is saying, don't be divided and say to yourselves, I'm better than you are. I myself find myself doing that at times, looking at others and saying, Oh my goodness. I'm glad that I'm better than that. Shame on me. I'm not better than any of you. I, like the rest of the world, depend upon God's grace and God's grace alone. I, like the rest of the people in the world, am a sinner in need of God's forgiveness every day. And so let's not get caught up in who's better, who's smarter, who has the best information. No, let's listen to what Paul has to say. He says, is Christ divided? No, Christ is not divided. Was Paul crucified? No, it isn't Paul that we follow. We are following Christ. And Christ alone. And so if we keep our eyes on Christ, if we, as I said to the children in the children's message, if we come to church on Sunday to praise God for what he has done, to come here because of what Jesus has done, and to focus on that, we will not be divided. But if we focus on what's the right song or the bad song, if we focus on what we're going to put in front of church or what we're not going to have in front of church, or what's going to be allowable for coffee after church, what's not going to be allowable, if we come looking to see if the church is clean or not, if it's the way we want it to be or not, that's not what we're here for. And listen, we don't do that simply on Sunday. We do that every day of the week. We are a people who worship God 7 days out of the week. And so we have to keep that perspective each day. Now, that doesn't mean we can't have opinions. But too often we voice our opinions not out of love for each other, but out of pride. Too often we express our opinions not in order to encourage someone, but to puff ourselves up. Maybe we do need encouragement. Maybe we are feeling low, but it comes from honesty. It comes through Christ, and it comes through people that will help encourage us. We don't have to encourage ourselves. We have others that will encourage us and help us. And so the answer given is we have Christ and Christ alone. He said, I'm glad I didn't baptize more of you. He listed the few people that he remembered baptizing, and he's saying, I'm glad I didn't baptize you because then you would probably, I'd be a problem because you'd say, well, I follow Paul because Paul baptized me. Paul is saying, keep your eyes and your focus on Christ. Who are you following? Who are you following? Ask yourself that. Are you following a social media platform? Twitter's available again. Are you following a certain person of this earth? A guru? Someone who you think has all the right ideas, or are you following Christ? Christ is the one who paid the price. Christ is the one who died. And so Corinth is a city that has all these different options, all these different opportunities, these people that they could listen to, these people that they could follow and be their followers, I'll say. But Paul says, don't forget who you are to follow. Don't forget why you are here. Follow Christ and Christ alone. Scripture tells us that we cannot serve one master. When we serve two masters, we will love the one and hate the other. There's only one person we can really follow. And I always like to use the example of the big spoked wheel, where you have a big wheel, and in the middle you have a center hub, and on it you have many spokes that go out. And we often live outside on the circle, right? That's where things happen. That's where the wheel rolls. And we go around the wheel, and we go back and forth to different people. All these people are on the wheel. But all these people are connected to the center, to the hub. And so the only way that we really can connect with people is if we go back all the way to the center, to Christ, and then we go back to that person. Because our relationships, just like marriage, are grounded in Christ. If we are to love our neighbor as we love ourselves, we have to have Christ in the center of that relationship. And if we have Christ in the center of those relationships, in church and outside of church, well, especially in church, there will be no divisions. Outside of church, there may be, because some people may reject Christ and say, I want nothing to do with what you are here to offer. And so we are set apart, as we said last week, consecrated for loyalty. What's your loyalty to? I know. When I was farming, I was loyal to green, John Deere green. I never had a red piece of equipment. We have loyalties. But what's the one loyalty that stands above all of them? And if we can put our finger on what that loyalty is, if it's not Christ, we better change. Because our number one loyalty should be and has to be Christ. Because Paul says there is no room for divisions in the church. It's not allowed. Because we are one body serving the head. And so, follow Christ and Christ alone. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we have so many things going on in our life, so many things that we are involved in, and we get busy. And we devote our time to so many things. And sometimes they take our loyalty. And we begin to follow them and serve them because they are important to us. No, Lord, we thank you for all these opportunities and these things that we are able to participate in. But help us, please, Lord, help us so that we do not lose sight of our loyalty. So that we do not lose sight of who we are following while we are doing these things. That we are following you and you alone. And while we follow you, we know that you have things for us to do. Things that are going to affect the kingdom in a positive way. Things that are going to spread your love and share the good news to others. And so help us, Lord, to be undivided, to be unified in the truth, and to be one with you and each other. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.